thank you. So the talk would be about simplified virtual machine for multi-engine Prolog, and it's a kind of generic talk title that I'm a little bit reusing. I thought that it would be just about the Warren Abstract machine and the state of the art, but I kind of got into a coding for 3 weeks and a completely new abstract machine came out after that. Was, you know, I didn't think it would work, but then it did. And this is more or less focusing on that one. The advantage of that is that it's about 1,000 lines of beautiful Java code, beautiful because Java is beautiful compared to the alternative that are there. And now that we hear that Hotspot is particularly good at getting pretty close to C, it looks like it's not a major handicap to be in Java, especially if you are in a C-friendly Java, which this construction will be built on. An outline, because we cannot assume that Prolog is widely known. We'll try to replicate Shakespeare's complete work in 60 minutes. I think there is a show in London that's pretty good still there for getting you a bit used to Prolog in case you are not. And that would be Horncloth Prolog in 3 slides. Then we'll try to derive the execution algorithm step by step so that, in a way, the abstract machine, the virtual machine, comes out as a natural growth from that derivation process. Then, of course, to be moderately fast, you need to be very careful about low-level representations, even if you are in a moderately high-level language. So we'll discuss the heap representation that's at the same time, this time, executable code. So in the Warren Abstract Machine, which is the de facto standard for Prolog implementation, they look very much the same, how you represent terms on the heap, but they have different names and different tags. Well, in fact, they don't need to be that different. That's one of the things that will come out here. After that, we'll look at the execution mechanism as a form of iterated unfolding, a very naive and very simple way to see execution of Prolog. We'll look at some of the goodies in the implementation language. In Java 8 has streams, and there are nice compositional mechanisms to expose multiple answers that are returned by a Prolog engine at a given time. And then kind of a completely orthogonal issue is the indexing in Prolog. Prolog is made of thousands of clauses that have all different shapes and structure, and indexing is critical to have it run moderately fast. Some performance tests showing that we are relatively close to the best compiled system. This is more or less an interpreter, kind of halfway compiler. And then finally, we'll go a little bit over a short history of Prolog machines and summary and conclusions. So Prolog first, just an overall view. It's a YAVOIL, yet another very old language originating from the late 70s. But, you know, so is flying to the moon, right? It's in the late 60s, I guess. So it doesn't mean that we'll do it in the next 10 years necessarily again, okay? So that being said, it is true, but by being based on a 2,000-year-old formalism, which is predicate calculus, which has even lesser changes to chances to change, I think age doesn't show up as dramatically on Prolog as it would be on, let's say, Fortran or other languages of a similar age. So originally, Prolog comes from theorem proving, and Alan Robinson's unification algorithm was a big step forward there, because in a way it was executing an infinite number of inferences with one hit, two trees that unified covered all the infinity of subtrees that would fall in that inference step in terms of ground representation. So it's a very nice algorithm. We'll look into it in detail. And then Prolog merged from two different motivations. Kolmrauer in France was hunting for NLP, elegant NLP, natural language processing tools, especially grammars that handle kind of like attribute grammars, but better, moving things that you find in a different part in a natural language sentence to eventually match or unify with things that you find elsewhere. At Lambda Calculus based NLP at the same time, Montague grammars and a number of other things. And then Robert Kowalski at Imperial College with a famous saying, algorithms are logic plus control. So a nice separation of concerns between logic on one hand, kind of ideally separated from control on the other hand. So Prolog covers a computationally well-behaved subset of predicate logic. In the general case, after one gets rid of quantifiers, scolem functions and number of other things, and pushing existentials and universals from inside out and the other way around, and negation as well, then you get to something that's a disjunction if a conjunction. So the disjunction here if a conjunction there, I'm kind of simplifying. And at the same time, comma means and in Prolog, and semicolon means or in Prolog. So this kind of situation is relatively hard because it's A or B if C and D and E, but then you don't know which is it. Is it A, it is B, it is both, okay? So general theorem proving handling this or here is in computationally big trouble. It's very hard. On the other hand, Horn clauses, I think Alfred Horn might also be an English logician from 1951-52, when he came up with those Horn clauses. So a very simple form, A is true if B and C and D are true, okay? Of course, you have variables and it's a bit more complicated than that, but quantifiers are all universal if you have variables. So you don't put them because they are all the same, right? Why should we put them? And multiple answers can be returned, and bit improperly people in logic programming call them non-deterministic execution, but that's not the case. They come out in a well-defined sequence, so it's not like non-determinism due to parallelism, but anyway, that's the wording there, and I occasionally will commit the crime to say non-deterministic execution, but we are prevented now. Some new derivatives in Prolog. Constraint programming was a very nice natural match to Prolog. We just extended the unification algorithm with constraint propagation, so kind of looking ahead at what could happen and then not doing things that you shouldn't. Triggering coroutining by suspending some computations that were waiting for some other data, so kind of data flow-like execution came in the 80s, early 90s as well. Satisfiability solving is a very interesting alternative that comes kind of from bottom up. This time you transform everything to propositional logic. And then, despite of being an NP-complete problem, Boolean satisfiability, because it's not uniformly hard, it's just hard for some very tricky examples. And why it is so, it's kind of easy to explain. There is only one case when a sentence is in conjunctive normal form is unsatisfiable. But all the truth value combinations give you zero. And it's satisfiable if at least one shows up. So the two at n minus one cases when it is satisfiable, and one when it is not, okay? So, you know, it's NP complete because the worst case will hit the case when takes a lot of trials until you find out the very last one if it's satisfiable or not. On the other hand, it's not contrary to, let's say, something in number theory that's used for cryptography, like factoring, right? Factoring is below NP somewhere, but is uniformly hard. You take two big primes, you multiply them, then good luck finding what they were originally, and that's except for, you know, if quantum computing is used and Shor algorithm, then until then, cryptography is reasonably unbreakable. So anyway, Horn clauses to get back here are then a well-behaved computational mechanism, and such solvers, variant of them called answer set programming, they exploit fast execution of propositional logic. Such solvers can handle millions of clauses and thousands of variables, despite of fighting an NP-complete problem, just to give you an idea of the size. On the other hand, as a comparison, and to put in perspective, like functional programming and also relational database languages, logic programmers claim that they are part of this family of declarative programming. Whatever declarative means, it's giving a bit less information on how the program should be executed and delegating as much of that to the underlying virtual machine. And that's happening elsewhere as well these days. So one of the interesting things about Prolog, Prolog disappeared from the TOB index for a few years because it was probably the AI winter, and Prolog was partly used in the in various AI applications. But currently, it made it back. So being above 50 is very bad. Not age-wise, but being above 50 in the TOB index. And Prolog now is slightly better than F#, which Microsoft worked pretty hard to push it, and slightly below Scala, which is a very cool object-oriented language as well. And Prolog is also higher than Haskell. Now, there are other scales for that, but this is a moderately interesting one that puts Prolog in perspective. As you see of the percentages, they're not high, right? For all of those languages compared to Java and C++ and C. So now we get to Horn clause, Prolog in three slides. We'll get suddenly more technical. So Prolog has three different components: unification, backtracking, and clause selection. So unification first, very simple examples for now. We'll show you a few more later. X equals A, and then Y equals X, transitivity, then it comes out that Y also equals A. So it propagates for as long chains as you want, and a good algorithm that uses some kind of union find define a route among all the variables that unify and then make all the other ones point to it. Prolog has compound terms, so f of x and b is like if you create a new object called f that has the fields x and b. So each time you see this compound term in Prolog in Java terms, think about making a new function object having those two arguments. And if you unify two of those, then X becomes A and Y becomes B. So information flows both ways, and it's recursively the case. Okay, that's a quick approximation of how that works. Prolog has clauses, multiple clauses having the same predicate symbol form a predicate. So A is a predicate, B is another one. And clauses could be either facts, independently true, and then they could also be rules. C of X is true if A of X is true and B of X is true. So it means that when you start executing and you call, for instance, a of x, then these candidates show up, they bind and unbind on backtracking x to be either 1 or 2 or 3. And then that binding for x would be checked in this case by b, who would look among the b's and see which of them are happy with that binding. And in this case, it's just a set intersection, so you will see that the answer that comes out from this rule, from the second rule, would be r equals 2 or 3, because 2 and 3 would be the ones on which a and b agree here. But also because c has also a fact, it's a predicate with two clauses, it also unconditionally could be true for r equals 0. So that's how Prolog navigates through the sea of clauses, which is called the Prolog database, and extracts the ones that match and progresses in computing possibly multiple answers. A very interesting thing, which was partly the original motivation for introducing Prolog by Alan Kormelauer, is definite clause grammars. If you use an arrow notation in Prolog, like A0 becomes A1, A2, AN, then this compiles, it's like a macro expansion mechanism that actually it happens right after the abstract syntax tree is built and the parser finishes its work. It can even be dynamically hooked in so that you can define your own macro expansion mechanism. This becomes a Prolog rule of the form A0 if from state S0 you go to state SN in the input string that you want to parse. And that becomes, well, A1 should do part of the job, go from S0 to S1, then further S1 should go to S2, and at the very end, AN should bring you from SN minus 1 to this same SN. So it's basically a split, think about a sentence made of multiple words, and then each of the components, like a nominal group or the verb group, taking their share and parsing what belongs to them and then all integrating. And of course, you can have extra argument and then you obtain the same kind of propagation of attributes that you can do in something like YAC or any attribute grammar mechanism. And unification can be used at any time to ensure that constraints like in natural language, something like gender should match in languages that have it, and more complex things, anaphora resolution needs to be covered from whose pronouns here matching the reference there. So it's relatively useful also for defining composition of relation of functions. So if f rewrites as gh, that means that f gets an input and an output. If g takes the input, creates an output, let's say temporary here, and then h takes that temporary and creates another out. So with some extra notation, you can also embed between curly brackets a call to Prolog, and you can define terminal symbols, the ones that don't expand further that we use for single words in English, for instance, or tokens in a programming language, where you just put them in brackets and they would not be analyzed further. So that's now the next step. A two-clause meta-interpreter. So we know about nice meta-interpreters in Lisp or Scheme, like eval. JavaScript has an eval that could be written in JavaScript if you really want to. In Prolog, this is two clauses. So here's our meta-interpreter. I'm using a list notation, slightly different from how Prolog represents clauses. I also use something called difference list. This is a list here, and then it ends with a tail, and I am returning that tail as another argument. So if I bind the tail, then this clause suddenly gets longer in constant time. So just a very popular trick among Prolog programmers. So let's look at the meta interpreter. If you have no goals left, the list of goals to solve is empty, you are finished. Otherwise, if you have a goal followed by multiple goals, then unify the first goal with the head of a clause. Clauses would look like this. And extend the body of that clause, this little tail variable here, with whatever goals you have left, But the ones that you unfold here, the G, its body actually prevails, so the prologue execution mechanism is basically a depth-first exploration of it's very much like a grammar would do, explore the left symbol first and then further down the same way. Handwritten recursive grammar for parsers works very much like an LL1 or LLK grammar written by hand. So if you run the meta-interpreter, indeed it works. Meta-interpret goal R. This is addition in base 1, successor arithmetic. Add 0 to x means just x. Add successor of x, that's just a compound term, an s wrapping up whatever, and y gives you the successor of z, provided that the addition of x and y gives z. And then a goal says add 2 plus 2, and then the result here is the magic number 4 as a result of 2 plus 2. So this is all you need to mimic prologue's execution in prologue itself. Now, we'll see that when we go a bit further and we want to derive an execution algorithm that happens in a less friendly environment, let's say more or less procedural language like Java, then a few more steps need to be performed to expand some of those implicit steps that happen naturally in prologue into real code that mimics it in the implementation language. So let's go to an equational form. Unification, which can be actually entered at the terminal, is basically the equality symbol. T equals add S of X, Y, and S of Z. Whoops, a parenthesis missing here. Can be rewritten as a conjunction of three equations. So first, you introduce a new variable, SX, and another new one, SZ. They kind of stand for those compound terms here. And then you say that SX actually means S of X, and then SZ means S of Z. So you can flatten all the terms, as many levels you want, to this linear equational form. And then if you have a conjunction, you just put them all together. So when you have a conjunction of let's say, two clauses here to keep it small, like C equals the set of those two clauses, those two terms making up a clause, this is the head, this is the body, then you would have C equals with a pattern, H and B. Those would be just the top level handlers or pointers toward the parts of the clause that you want to transform to this equational form, and then H would be the addition of a flat term that has no compound terms inside, and so on recursively. So you will see here an equational form, variables on the left and flat simple terms on the right. So that's in a way the essence of pushing down unification to something that would then generate some form of instructions that either in de facto standard implementation, which is a Warren abstract machine, or what you will see happening here in a few minutes. So the list of variables can be seen as a top-level skeleton, this one here, abstracting away the main components of a Horn clause, the head, H, and the body, B in this case, but the body can have more than one element. So very, very simple data structures to represent the clauses. Now, as a small surprise here, the natural language equivalent of the equational form, this will become our assembler. So, okay, why use those symbols if we could have a reserved word called if, another reserved word called and, and the dot at the end to finish it all. Then we say add SX, Y, SZ if SX holds, oh, that's a reserved word as well, SX and SZ holds, SZ and add X, Y, Z. So this is our assembler, not as unreadable as, let's say, Intel's, right? Slightly more friendly to humans. And in theory, you can speak it to Siri on your iPhone and say, make me a prologue sentence out of it, if you ever get to that point in which programming would be based on speaking in your program rather than, you know, typing it in. Okay, so let's note the correspondence between those symbols and the prologue's clause neck. That's another idiom. This is the neck, is the if application. Okay, looks a bit like a neck as well. And the conjunction symbol. Note also the correspondence between holds and the use of equals, which helps expressing the unification operation between a variable and a flattened prologue term. The top-level skeleton of the clause can be kept implicit as it is easily recoverable, so you don't need to keep that as a separate term. And this will be, as I said, our assembler language. So now, to start building the actual implementation, we need a simple tokenizer that splits into words sentences delimited by dot. So that's a 101 homework assignment, right? If you want to give it to someone, you know, there's some nice tokenizers that just do it for you. I use the Java 1.0 Gosling tokenizer because it was fast and easy, but I think it's a trivial exercise to write a tokenizer and a parser for this. Now we are able to do a small so-called expressiveness lift, allowing variables in functional or predicate symbol positions. There's some transformations to prologue, one of them is called highlog, in which instead of having first order predicate syntax, you have higher order predicate syntax, which means variables could be in predicate symbol positions. And here's an example. If she likes she likes beer, if she likes fries, and she drinks alcohol. So that's our assembler statement for, and she is a variable, right? That's why she's uppercase. We're not talking about female monarch or anything like that, in which case it would warrant the uppercase as well. So a prologue syntax element, it is uppercase for variables, lowercase otherwise, and quotes if you want to be polite and use people's names in uppercase. That with texting, nobody does that anyway anymore. So, okay, so we can drop this prologue restriction for a form of higher order syntax. And we want a bit of notational improvements because lists are very frequently used in prologue. So we say X lists ABC, and that expands to X hold list new variable underscore zero. Underscore is also a spatial uppercase character that can be used for variables. Variable zero holds list B variable one, and variable one holds list C nil, nil being the end of the list, right? So that's a very natural expansion, much as the heap representation, as you will see in a minute for a list. If we look at this running example that we are playing with, the addition for successor arithmetic and then a goal that runs it with 2 plus 2, then the natural language assembler code for it would be add 0 to x is x, add variable 0 to y gives variable 1, and variable 0 holds s of x, and variable 1 holds s of z if the addition of x, y, and z, the x and y gives z. So moderately readable. And then our goal that actually builds a very large number, which is 2, goal r if add variable 1 and variable 0 and 1 giving r, and 0 holds successor of 2, and 2 holds successor of the next one, and so on, okay? Might have a typo here. That shouldn't be zero, probably. Okay. So the type of the heap representation now, one step further. We instruct our tokenizer to recognize variables, symbols, and small integers as primitive data types. We develop a Java-based interpreter in which we represent our prologue terms top-down, the most naive and simple representation you can have for a tree structure. Java's primitive integer type is used for tagged words. There is no such thing as long arrays in Java, but if you would make this in C, you could use long longs and have a much more scalable, large memory image execution model. So we instruct the parser to extract as much information as possible by making marking each word with a relevant tag. So I wrote an interpreter in Scala, which is a very nice object-oriented language a few years ago, maybe two or three, which did nothing that was low level at all. It used object-oriented unification. Every term type knew what to do when it meets another one, and they were just kind of talking to each other. So very elegant design. It's called Styla. It's about three times as slow as this, but relatively nice. And that was my experiment with as higher level, as purely object-oriented constructs as possible. And for this one, I said, well, let's play the C game, be as close as possible to C and see what happens then. And indeed, what seems to be the case with the hotspot predictions, if you look like C in Java, then you more or less will run about as fast or pretty close to whatever you would do in C otherwise. So the runtime, first the tags, variables, first occurrence is kind of important because then you might have to create something that becomes also the root of a unification, reference chain in the unification algorithm, a second or other occurrence of a variable, a reference to an array slice representing a subterm. That's also kind of a spatial case of pointers. Those three in C would be just tagged pointers. And then a constant, a symbolic constant, something sitting in the symbol table, and then a plain small integer. And then the array marker itself with a tag that also contains the length up to the size of an integer. We call lengths arities in Prologue because a predicate has an arity, which is the number of arguments. So that's another word that occasionally might pop up instead of the length of an array slice holding a flattened term. And let's look at the actual example here for making those nicely inlineable in Java. So to emulate the existence of distinct types for tagged words and their content, we do a trick. We flip the sign when tagging and untagging. That's unnecessary, obviously. But then if the devil does anything for things going wrong, what can you do is mixing up pointers and words, right, to which they point. Everyone does that, and it's easy to do, and it's hard to catch. So what we do here, because we don't live in a typed world, integers are just integers, we flip the sign. So each time when you tag something, it would be a negative thing. And then each time when you untag, or detag, you flip it back. Okay. Otherwise, three-bit tags here, and that's one of those things that could save you in an untyped representation from making too many mistakes. Okay, the top-down representation of the terms now. Again, our running example here. This is to what it compiles, that natural language assembler. And now on the heap, somewhere starting at address 5, we have an array of four elements. The first one is the symbol C, the constant marker C, marking the add symbol. Then we have a reference to position 10, which is here, where an array will be found for the subterm, S of X in this case. And then we have a variable at first occurrence V in position 8. That corresponds, I guess, to that intermediate variable here. And then it goes like that. You have references, arrays, constants, variables at first occurrence, array markers, arity markers, and this is the actual length of the array. So array 4 means that there are 4 elements in this expanded thing. If you look at this here, is 1, 2, 3, 4, right? So that's the flattened form of the prolog term that has that length. And then you get something called the skeleton that gives you an abstraction of what's here, a reference to position 5, where everything starts, the head of the clause mostly, and the list of references to where the segments of the body being a conjunction, would be here just on, just one, because we have only one body element, but they could be many. So we can now look at prolog clauses as descriptors of heap cells. The parser places the cells composing a clause directly to the heap, so we bypass traditional definitions of this is the code area, or and this is the stack or the heap, the runtime. We just collapse those, and we'll see that there are a few advantages to have things ready to execute on the heap itself. A descriptor defined by a small class, which looks like a struct in C, more or less, is created and collected to the array called clauses. So all the clauses that we read at parsing time get collected to an array. And then a few things that make this descriptor contain the essential information about what a clause used to be before it got compiled to this representation. The base of the heap, where the cells start, the length of the code of the clause, that's good to know. The neck of the clause, this is where the head of the clause and the body are separated, like with humans as well. An array GS, that's the top level skeleton of a clause containing references to the location of its head and the body elements, very much like what I showed you here. Just the references, the pointers, where those components exist. And finally, something that's a kind of a late addition, the index vector containing the reference constants. I will show you a little bit later what the referencing means, but basically following those variable chains until you hit either a constant or a variable that's unbound. Numbers or array sizes as extracted from the outermost term of the head of the clause, and zero values marking variable position. So that's basically the heap representation. So now we get back to our meta interpreter, the two-liner, and we try to replicate it in Java. So first, to procedurally emulate our meta interpreter, we need to understand the mechanism. So what did we do in the meta interpreter? We just took the first goal and replaced it with the body of a clause whose head was matching that first goal. And that's called unfolding. So it's a repeat process until there is nothing to unfold. So the two possibilities that could happen here, unification is the mechanism that selects the good candidate clauses. If it's successful, we extend the list of goals with the elements of the body of the clause to be solved first, because prolog goes depth first. And the relatively unorthodox observation that comes out from this is that indexing, which in the one abstract machine is heavily interleaved with all the other unification instructions, so logic and control are not separated at all in that implementation. Indexing is an orthogonal issue, and we try to separate it as much as we can from the main unification engine that we will develop first, and then we'll look at indexing as a separate issue. We still find a nice indexing algorithm, but we don't interleave them as every prolog engine I know, including mines, does. So just because everyone does something, it doesn't mean you should, you know. Doesn't mean also you shouldn't, but you may not. Okay, as we do not assume that predicate symbols are non-variables, it makes sense to design also a different indexing algorithm, because we kind of lifted the semantics. We don't need predicate symbols in predicate position anymore. As you remember from that example with she drinks beer, she was the predicate symbol in first argument position. So we need a convenient way a bit later to plug in indexing as a refinement for our iterated unfolding mechanism. And Java has streams for that and a nice algebra of streams, so we'll figure out a way to just mix them together in a relatively elegant way. So let's take a look at unification. Unification descends recursively and binds variables to terms in corresponding position. And full unification is an expensive operation. Our relatively rich stack system reduces the need for that. And the Warren abstract machine, in fact, is designed to compile away simple unification instruction that occur at the surface of a term into machine instructions so that they don't do any recursion and they just deal directly with registers and the heap and movements between those two. What we do here, we do also pre-unification. So we want to filter out the losers. That's a popular term in US presidential election. So the losers would be the ones that, they look very nice, but they have no chance to pass the unification test and proceed to further resolution steps. We look at some low-level aspects of unification that tend to be among the most frequently called operation of a prolog machine. So doing a profiling at instruction level on existing machines is a very good idea before you design a new VM, so you kind of see what really matters in terms of optimization and what doesn't. So back to unification again. You remember this example here. X is Y, Y is A, then everyone is A. If it's a bit deeper than that, you have F of X and G of X with H of Z, Z, and then U here, and then finally learning that Z equals A. That gives you those bindings, everything that overlaps in the same position acquires the bindings, and then that propagates by transitivity. Now, things can be worse. Here you have X, Y, Z, that's a list. And here you have F of Y, Y, G, Z, Z, H, A, B. And you see that this very quickly creates a very big term X. So you could have actually the devil's own examples in which relatively small terms as a result of unification can get exponentially bigger. But anyway, they don't necessarily get that big on the heap because most of those pointers point to shared data objects, like we are pointing to the same G if there are multiple Gs, like this G here and this G here are the same on the heap. So the term looks big when you write it out, but internally it's not necessarily big. The referencing, this is the critical step that we use for prolog in all virtual machines. When you do unification, a variable can form a long chain. X points to Y, Y points to Z, Z finally points to something that's a constant or a compound term. Or Z is completely unbound. It's one of those variables that we marked with V, the root variables. So the referencing is a quick loop that you do. While something is a variable, you just get its reference, look it up on the heap, and then if you ever bump into a reference that points to itself, we arrange that unbound variables point to themselves. That's a classic thing in Prolog. They could point to null if you have it, but then your programs are a bit more error prone. We don't kind of like to hit null, I guess. That's the superstition accidentally. So variables are self-referential as pointers on the heap if they are unbound. So we have two inlineable methods here, very quick one, isvar. Well, we arranged for tags to be smaller than two, and everyone that's smaller than two is then a variable. So one JVM instruction, I guess, for this. And then get the reference, which is just heap at d tag of x, all clearly inlineable, just to make sure we declare them final, but I removed the word final to fit in the slide, and final and private just in case. Okay. So the pre-unification step, we need to detect matching clauses without copying to the heap. So there are a few interesting things here. One can filter matching clauses by comparing the outermost array of the current goal with the outermost array of a clause head. The register array, which is just a Java array, we don't have real registers here, it will contain a copy of the outermost array of the goal element we are working with, and it holds only the referenced elements, because a given goal might want to match with multiple clauses, hundreds sometimes. In WordNet, you have thousands. So dereferencing once, for instance, it's efficient rather than dereferencing all the time. So this register vector also appears in the Warren abstract machine kind of as an a priori good thing. We all know that registers are a good thing when we have them. And here it appears at, as a deductive step, because that avoids multiple dereferencing. Another interesting thing here is that we use the prototype of a clause head that the clause representation is already on the heap. So to copy it and make it an activation record, all you have to do is a very quick address translation, fast loop, and then everything that needs to be relocated gets relocated, rather than having a recursive pass to copy, as we would do in a Prolog in which the heap is a bit of a mess and unorganized, which the Warren abstract machine actually does. But it's still a arguably good design, because it only copies to the heap what really needs to be copied. So here we differ a little bit from that, and we'll see the pros and the cons in a minute. So the referencing is avoided when working with material from heap represented clauses. They have nothing that would have created reference chains, as our tags will tell us that first occurrences of variables do not need it at all, and the others need a getref exactly once, because they would just refer to the original root variable. So everything is statically clear for us about how clauses would look on the heap, and that's simplifying this pre-unification step. So finally, we get to do the hard work. We just postponed it a bit, unification and trailing. So we unfold it to registers the outermost array of the current goal corresponding to predicate arguments, and then we'll start by unifying them when needed with the corresponding arguments of a matching clause. Now we have always fully dynamic arrays, no a priori constraint on size, contrary to Java stacks that seem to be fixed. So our arrays expand if they are full, double in size, and then if they are a quarter full, then they shrink to half. That's the classic dynamic array algorithm. We use an integer stack to eliminate recursive function in the unification algorithm, but it's a relatively efficient dynamic array. We use trailing. Everyone knows from editors, undo lists, right? You do something and then it's terrible, and then you say undo, 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 and you can go back for as long as you want. They even trickier things, like I remember some Emacs can pick up a bunch of things to undo and then undoes those selectively. So anyway, trailing is Prolog's undo list. It's called the trail for some historic reasons. I don't know exactly why. It's the trail of the computation that you followed, I guess, and then you walk back on it, something like that. And it's just a glorified undo list. And the way it works is that you put the variable addresses that you touched in the unification algorithm. When X becomes A, you bind X, you place A in the place where X is, or you make, if needed, X point to something. And then you mark X as being bound, and you put it on the trail. When you do backtracking, you go and you unbind X by making it point again on itself. So that's the trailing and untrailing operation. Now, to avoid unnecessary work, and that's classic Prolog, variables at higher addresses are bound to those at lower addresses on the heap. And after binding, variables are trailed when lower than the heap level corresponding to the current goal. Why are we doing that? Well, when you fail, the complete heap segment is discarded at once. So any objects that exist there that got wrong bindings disappear. On the other hand, the ones that are deep and they happen to be unlucky enough to point towards newer data, well, they would need to be reset to unbound for the next round of unification operations. But fortunately, the majority usually is not on the trail. So undoing in Prolog is then in a way very fast. And that makes Prolog extremely good for backtracking heavy combinatorial generation examples, for instance, that in a functional language would be much slower than in Prolog. Okay, the stack-based unification algorithm now, let's look a little bit at the real thing. It's mildly optimized, it can be half the size if you keep it a bit higher level, but because it's in the inner loop, it needs to be fast. So while the unification stack is empty, and we pre-fill the unification stack at pre-unification stage, so we don't pass arguments to it, we just pass a stack that has on it whatever happens to make it to the stack in the pre-unification stage. So while your unification stack is not empty, the reference, what you get from the stack, two elements, the left and the right, that you want to unify, if they happen to be equal, you do nothing. You are finished for this particular thing, and you go back again to the while. If they happen to be different, though, then you start to look at the tags, and then you do a case analysis. If there are variables, you look who's older, who's younger. Older mean lower on the heap, and younger means closer to the top of the heap. And then, based on that, you bind either this one to that one or the other way, and then you do trailing as needed. This is the trailing operation here. Now, if they are not variables, then you get to the interesting case where you have to unify arguments of a compound term recursively. And this is, it could be the same, but because it's called actually first, it's the unify arcs function that goes over all the arguments of a term and unifies them. And of course, instead of calling recursively, it just pushes to the stack the things that need to be pushed to the stack for further evolution of the unification process. So that's relatively simple otherwise, but it's carefully optimized with everything that can be final is final, so that Java can execute the, generate a good JVM call for that. This is another element that helps with speed, fast linear term relocation. So we implement a relocation loop that speculatively places the clause head, including its subterms, on the heap. The single instruction multiple data, like operation, can benefit from parallel execution simply by the presence of multiple arithmetic units that modern CPUs have. And of course, if you want to play CUDA or OpenCL GPU implementation, then you can do speculatively those operations in parallel based on predicted future uses. Anyway, the relocation basically, a trivial parallelization would be split the array that you want to relocate in half and then put them on two different CUDA units and do the relocation there. But this is a very important inner loop operation that can help with the overall speed. So relocation is, you look at the tag, if it's smaller than 3, it means it's a relocatable element, it's a variable, a V, a U, or an R, so one of those need to be updated by a constant quantity. And that constant quantity is the same for all the relocation operations, so we compute it, of course, ahead of time. It would be the delta between the heap offsets where the closed prototype existed and where the relocated one needs to land. So we compute it only once and then use it in 50, 100 different places after that. That's a good thing as well. Compilers might do it for us. I don't know if Hotspot does it, but just take no prisoners, we do it directly. So that's the push sell operation that actually places the prototype clause that's exactly as the one that we will use for advancing in the resolution process that makes Prolog finding solutions. We just have a for loop here and we relocate, and this constant B is computed in advance before this push sell operation. Other little things that one should know about in whatever implementation, when you have a dynamic array and you know ahead of time that you would put an object of size k on it, you check for overflow one time in the beginning, and then if there is an overflow, you increment the array. If not, you leave it alone, and then you do safely without index checking all the push operations to push different cells. So you know the size, you measure if you have enough room, expand if needed, otherwise no index checking for the push operation. So that's a good speed up element as well. So new terms are built on the heap by the relocation loop in two stages. First the clause head, including its subterm, and then if unification succeeds, also the body. Very similar like the Warren Upsack machine, you don't place the body speculatively. First you make sure that the head unifies, head is usually tiny, you place it on the heap, you do the unification, then if you succeed, you start placing the body as well. So the push body operation does that operation. Push head is very simple, you just push the head cells, and then you return the relocated head, which would then be passed to the next level. So the code for push body is very similar. We relocate the skeleton as well, GS, that starts with the addresses of the first goal, so it is ready to be merged in the list of goals. And now we get to a new, very lightweight data structure called the spine, that will keep track of the runtime components that we need to keep track of the goals and also how far, how many clauses are left that we need to match. Traditionally, they are called the AND stack and the OR stack in Prolog because they correspond to AND operations to advance in a conjunction in the body, or to OR operations that correspond to selecting alternative clauses in the body of a in a program. So the goal stack is immutable. We can do that, and the price for that is minor. Because most of that gigantic spine that contains all the remaining galls is kind of shared among every activation record that sits on the spine stack. And this is the same thing as in my Scala-based implementation, Styla. Just observe that it has no impact on the performance to actually make it look nice as an immutable goal stack. So spine is a runtime abstraction of a clause, we can say that. It collects information needed for the execution of the goals originating from that clause. Goal elements on this immutable list are shared among alternative branches. The small methodless spine class declares the following fields: head, that's the head of the clause, base, location on the heap, an integer list, an immutable integer list, GS, the locations of the goal elements accumulated by unfolding clauses so far, the top of the trail, as it was when this clause got unified, and an integer k, that's the index of the last clause the top goal of the spine has tried to match so far. So if a predicate has like 10 clauses, is maybe we're at clause 7 now that we tried, we need to keep track of that. And then the registers, the referenced goal registers for the top goal, and then, of course, something that we will use later, possibly also for indexing, index elements that are based on the registers, kind of the constant parts and where they are located in the registers will serve for indexing later. The execution algorithm is not big at all. This is it. So let's go over a bit and keep in mind the two-clause meta-interpreter that's we want it to be as close as possible to. So we start with a spine and works through a stream of answers that are returned to the caller one at a time. So this is a resumable engine. In languages like Python, there is a yield, and in Ruby as well, and I guess in JavaScript, you can be in the middle of a for loop, yield something, and then resume the for loop, and it resumes from where you kind of left. So that's nice to be resumable, because then this is the building block for first order, first class engines in a way. We'll look at that in a minute. So while the spines are not empty, so the abstractions of the clauses, the goals are not empty, take the one that's at the peak of the spine stack. If it has clauses and if it has goals, then unfold it. If you hit a null, then you are more or less finished here, then you get further away. But otherwise, you do the typical steps. If it does not have goals, then you got to the end of the list of goals. So everything that could have been computed is computed. So this is actually the definition of an answer. You return it, but you make sure that you do it in a resumable way. Otherwise, you push this back to the spine stack because there is more work to do. If you get here, then if it has no more goals, then you pop the spine and you are completely done with that, and you unwind the trail to the place where you started with, so that unwind the trail removes all the bindings that variables up to that level suffered, so that they are ready for alternative clauses and alternative bindings. And at the very end, you return a null, but otherwise you return a spine. C is a spine that you return, okay? So the method that I called yield, just to look a bit like what all the languages except Java apparently, C# has it, everyone has it except Java for some reason, hard to understand why. It would have been much simpler to do a lot of high level languages if that was available. But this is an easy emulation for it, more or less, yield. And then the active component of a spine is then the topmost goal in the immutable goal stack. When there are no goals, then we return the answer, as I said, just summarizing what I showed you on the code. When there are no more matching clauses, the topmost spine is popped off. An empty spine stack indicates the end of the execution signaled by returning null, that's the no more answers available. And the key element in the interpreter loop is to ensure that after an engine yields an answer, it can, if asked to, resume execution and work on computing more answers. So from the outside, how this looks? Well, from the outside, we have the method ask. You initialize the query as being what yield gives you. If is null, you return null. Otherwise, you build an answer and you show it to the user in an external representation. Export term just kind of builds a more human readable term. And then you unwind the trail and then you return R. So this is the mechanism that you use to query. And each time you ask something, yield is actually called. So exposing the answers of a logic engine to the implementation language. So ultimately, answers need to be printed out. They need to be maybe integrated in a Java program that uses this Prolog subsystem. So we have answer streams for that. Java 8 streams are a nice and relatively general addition to Java that can be customized. If you use default streams for an array or something that are usually sequential, you can build your parallel streams a little bit by hand. And for that, you use something called a splitterator versus an iterator, so something that might split the domain over which it iterates in multiple parallel fragments. A moderately nice abstraction, very simple also for programmers to use streams without knowing anything about the underlying parallel implementation. So to build one of those, you have to define a few methods, among which this is the only one that's relevant. It's called try-advance. This would be the consumer object. That's a kind of a generic thing. And then what you do here, you would do an ask operation. You check if there are more answers. Then you say action accept if you see that this is not null, and then you return okay so that the stream mechanism passes that to the other level if needed. The nice thing about streams in Java 8 is that they are lazy. So basically when you define a stream, everything that the stream has to do, including filtering, summing up the results, any of those operations do not happen actually. They're almost kind of pushed from the filters and other objects that modify a stream to the execution point in the stream splitterator itself, and then they would be executed relatively efficiently there. So they are like promises of future execution that happen. So that much is very nice, this lazy one answer at a time return that we want to achieve. So now the more general mechanism, before streams were done in Java, we did it about 20 years ago as well because it looked just very interesting. So we had something called interactors. A more general thing than streams, but were basically the same thing otherwise. It encapsulated all the data structures, including file or socket streams that behave like a stream of answer obtained from a logic engine, except that you wanted also to talk to that stream. So it was like a somewhat intelligent stream to which you can talk back and forth. It was a bit of an agent-oriented abstraction. So first-class logic engines then have this ability to generate answer streams that come out. They are also able to be part of the internal representation of Prolog as first-class objects. You can build one from Prolog, query it, and then you can emulate basically everything in Prolog in terms of engines, including the complicated things like cut and the non-procedural extensions like dynamic databases, all can be emulated in terms of engines. So it's a very small, very powerful abstraction. So here's the API. You create a new engine, you give an answer pattern and a goal, and then you get back a handle, which is the interactor. Then it's very much like an iterator or a stream, and then you just say, give me the next element, and then it would trigger the execution and pulling out the next answer from a resumable engine that can be queried again for a new answer and so on. Get will be the thing that queries the engine. Stop will be the thing that stops it. And there is a convention to return a function symbol that wraps up the answer if it exists, and the constant no if there are no more answers. An interesting extension was that you have a return operation. Learned it a bit from monads in functional languages like Haskell, where there is this return operation that gets you out from the monadic computation. A logic engine could wait to the very end to return an answer when it finds it, but it could alternatively say, I have something useful that I want to return right now. I'm not finished, but this is very useful. So then you make a return statement and you can interrupt the engine, suspend it, and the client that called you can get that thing and start talking back to you, and you can resume if needed or not. But the dialogue between the two sides can go on more or less freestyle. So that was good. You can emulate things like exceptions. This is how trivial throw is implemented. Return a compound term called exception and the exception itself in it. So a number of things that otherwise people do in a very tricky way at abstract machine level are now source level with engines. So you can exchange data with an interactor. The API was designed to be very small, kind of constant space on the two sides. This is the engine, and you give the engine a term. That's usually the client or the master that created the engine. And then the engine receives it with from engine. It just sits in a buffer and takes it out from there, and that's enough to implement all the computation. So the API is very, very small. Some of the typical uses, the client creates and initializes a new engine. The client triggers a new computation in the engine, in which case the client first passes some data and a new goal to the engine, then issues a get operation, and then gets control back. The engine starts a computation from the initial goal or the point where it has been suspended, and runs a copy of the new goal received from its client. The engine returns a copy of the answer, then suspends and returns the control to the client. So this dialogue that exists can do interesting things. So those are a few things that I did with first class engines. You can define the complete set of ISO Prolog operations at source level. In fact, you can do even more, but that's really black magic. You can emulate engines in Hornclaw's Prolog as well. You can implement Erlang-style messaging with millions of engines. Engines are very lightweight, and all the data areas are dynamic, so you can do the kind of agent programming constructs that you could do with Erlang. You can implement Lynda blackboards for relatively nice communication as well. Prolog dynamic databases can be implemented at source level, a bit slower than otherwise. And then other things like an algebra for composing engines and their answer streams, as well as tabling operations can be implemented. So multi-argument indexing, I will probably skip that part and just try to summarize it for you, because we are running a bit out of time. Basically, what you do for multi-argument indexing, you just the set intersection, you can have as many arguments as you want. Each of them has a matching set of clauses that have a constant in the same position and that specific index. And then you do a fast set intersection algorithm. And of course, instead of using heavy maps in Java, you use integer maps for speed. But that's basically the algorithm. And then you connect a stream to that as well, so that intersection is in fact lazily computed. The number of interesting spatial cases, for very small programming, you should not do it at all, up to maybe 20 clauses, maybe more. If the program is gigantic, you should use Bloom filters. Bloom filters use kind of one something bit per average per thing that's in. They cannot list what's in, but they can say like an oracle, this is in, this is not, okay? So for very large databases, except for one argument index, you would use Bloom filter for all the others, and then you get a significant space saving. A matching to streams for embedding the two different aspects in one is a good thing, and the indexing is an orthogonal mechanism compared to the rest of the unification engine. So some performance tests, very quickly. So performance, I expect it to be bad. This is an interpreter. It was 3 weeks. I spent 20 years otherwise for the compilers and refine them. Well, it's not that bad, actually. It's within a factor of 2 from my fastest Java-based compiler, which itself is in a factor of 2, slightly less than 2, from a C-based prolog like SWI prolog. So we are about 4 times at most slower than SWI, which is in C, and the compiler, and we are an interpreter, and we are in Java, okay? So it's a reasonable factor, given the simplicity of this. And here we see the 11 queens computed relatively fast, permutations of 11 plus reverse operation, and then one single solution that is the permutation of 11, plenty of those, that happens to match the reversed one. Sudoku 4x4, very small, 288 solution or something. And then the meta interpreter, the two-liner, running a permutation program, you see that the meta interpreter is not that bad, in fact, compared to the plain one. This is the plain one, about 3 times slower to meta interpret than not, which is also relatively good. So just a short history of prolog machines now to finalize. Well, the Warren abstract machine is, as I mentioned it multiple times, the de facto golden standard for implementing prolog. It uses registers, 2 stacks, one for goals, one for choices, the alternatives. It has the heap and the trail, so we borrowed instinctively those things, and no other choice. There is a very good tutorial by Hassan Ait Kassi that explains it. Warren's own report is moderately unreadable about, you know, how he did it. Still used to replicate the fine points if needed. I did a few simplified Warren abstract machines by a continuation passing transformation that has then been used in a number of different implementations. Currently, the fastest indexing scheme is in YAP and in SWI prolog. It's called just-in-time indexing. There are a number of alternative designs like Neng Fazu's B-prolog that's kind of stack frame based. And then there are higher order extensions as well, like HiLog, David S. Warren's HiLog. There are a lot of interesting extensions related to constraint programming that are built on top of prolog, either at source level or halfway source level and C level, depending on the implementation. There is a TCPLP, that's the major logic programming journal, that overviews some of the prolog machines that are still alive and in a way interesting enough to talk about. So they are those here. It's about 2 years 3 years old that came out. So this design in context, I kind of compared it as we went. The closest thing is this very high-level styler system that uses object-oriented unification. And then there are a number of things that we borrow from the Eclipse system that's at Imperial College here, I think. And like the heap representation is very nice that they have. So we borrow a few things from different implementations, especially in terms of data representations. And this is a very quick bibliography of what we covered. We have the slides probably on the web anyway, so you can go over those. And I'm finally at the summary and the conclusions. So by starting from a two-line meta-interpreter, we have captured the necessary step-by-step transformations that one need to implement a procedural language that mimics the meta-interpreter. By deriving kind of from scratch a fairly efficient Prolog machine, we have made, hopefully, the design a bit more intuitive. You would have suffered much more if I would have went through the Warren abstract machine or anything similar. And we have decoupled the indexing and kind of kept it in this talk. We proposed also this natural language looking assembler that's very good for teaching assembler at kindergarten, if anyone wants to do that. And also minimal efforts from tokenizing and parsing. There's a small Prolog program that generates that from the code source that's part of the distribution that's written in SWI Prolog. And we believe that future ports of the design can help with embedding logic programming in either software or hardware components, from JavaScript-based implementation to do logic in the web, or to a hardware implementation for an embedded system. So that's basically it. The complete thing is at my homepage. Let me stop on the link. I remember putting the link here. It's still a bit work in progress, but being about 1,000 lines, it's much easier to play with it than a normal implementation. I will definitely add it, and it's in my 2015 research folder. So.